Of backbenchers, and it looks like we have some hardcore backbenchers back there. You're welcome to come up front if you wish. It's quite nice out here. Friendly people, too. So thank you for staying. Thank you for staying. So the topic I wanted to discuss next is around innovation. And the what if is, what if every company had a culture of innovation? Now, when we think about innovation, often the discussion is around certain companies, the Apples of the world, being distinct and unique relative to every other company, and somehow showing certain features that are somehow very different from those others. So we'll look at how this might be changing if everybody had, many more companies had, a culture of innovation. What if, rather than one goldfish, it's a school of companies that are indeed moving forward much more rapidly. The other part I wanted to note is, when we think about innovation, and especially when we think about culture, both, and especially culture, seem like fuzzy concepts. What is culture? It's something ephemeral. We can't put our hands to it. What my colleagues and I have been doing over the last several years is trying to measure and understand the dimensions of culture and look for what is common across companies, across nations, indeed dozens of nations, and various sizes and industries. What is common among the companies that share a culture of innovation? So what I wanted to do in the next few minutes is talk about the future. That is, after all, the focus of our discussion here for the day. The present and the past. So we'll engage in foresight, the logic being skate to where the puck is going to be, not where it has been. Insight, learning from each other. And ourselves about where the future might be, because some of us, some of you, are probably experiencing my future right now, ahead of me. So the future is already here, it's just unevenly distributed. Some are ahead of others, and perhaps we could learn from that. And finally, those who forget the lessons of history are condemned to repeat it. We'll learn, in fact, we'll spend a fair bit of time thinking about history. So speaking of history, I wanted to spend part of our time talking about Chinese history and the lessons Chinese history, in particular, an episode from Chinese history implies for us, and the what-if question of what if every company had a culture of innovation. And for that, I need to introduce you, and some of you I recognize have been in my classes, you've been introduced to this gentleman before, Admiral Teng He, the Chinese admiral. So anyone here, how many of you have heard of Admiral Teng He? Some of you have, yes. For those of you who haven't, in the 1400s, Admiral Teng He led what certainly at that point, and arguably for many centuries since, was the largest expedition of exploration around the world. Specifically, between 1405 and 1433, Teng He was led a group of 300 ships up to 400 feet long. 37,000 crew members. They came to my hometown in South India, a place called Cochin. You can imagine the shock and awe that would have happened if 37,000 Chinese suddenly show up one fine day in ships that no human being at that point had ever laid eyes on at that size. It was 7 expeditions. We have data that suggests that they visited at least 30 countries. Just to give you by way of contrast, that ship you see, the large ship there, is Cheng He's treasure junk, the main ship. The little one there is Christopher Columbus's Santa Maria, 80 years later. Just to appreciate,
compared with European vessels, the change, Cheng He's treasure junks were giants. They were the largest wooden ships ever built. feet long and 180 feet wide, they were powered by bamboo sails on 9 masts that could be set to any angle of the wind. At the stern were the compass room, admiral's quarters and galley. Down below were the crew, animals and cargo. The ship was kept afloat by 13 watertight compartments. Each could be flooded separately and used as a fish tank or a washing area. This technology was 500 years ahead of the West. It was used in the building of the Titanic.
We know how that turned out, the Titanic. And so hundreds of miles, indeed thousands of miles of exploration all around. And yet, all of that power, all of that innovation, all of that exploration is barely known, has been barely known until recently. It became a crime punishable by death by 1440 to build a ship with more than one mast in China. By 1440, all of that was gone. And many have wondered the what if. What if China had continued to innovate? What if China had not stopped and shut itself off from the rest of the world? Why did this happen? Before I answer that question, and that is a question that has implications for all of us, even if we're not running entire countries, each of us as individuals as well as corporate leaders, before we answer that question, it's worth contrasting the fate of Admiral Zheng He with the fate of Christopher Columbus. So this was Admiral Zheng He's benefactor, the Chinese emperor, the Ming emperor, the second Ming emperor, so the so-called Yongle emperor. Now, if you're a student of innovation or of history, it is worth going to, there I am, a student of innovation, to the Ming tombs outside Beijing to learn about what was happening there. But certainly, the Chinese emperor was the benefactor, and he was the visionary who allowed Zheng He to go out and explore. But he passed away. The next generation of leaders did not see the value in exploration. They were being attacked in the present. So while they were trying to create ideas, innovations for the future, they had to deal with challenges in the present. They were attacked by invaders. Think of them as today's competitors, invaders from the West. So the bureaucrats said, we have to do something, otherwise we won't have a country. And so they built what is now the parts of the Great Wall that tourists go to, the Bada Ling section in this case, for instance, was built during that period in order to repel the attacks. The bureaucrats, in addition to fortifying for the present, also said, what has the exploration so far given to the Chinese people? What has been the payoff? You know, it's been a few years. We were talking earlier about patience and long-term vision. Well, these guys said, it's been a few years. We haven't really seen very much payoff. We've seen a few exotic animals come through. This is what they called the vegetarian tiger who came to. They brought a giraffe all the way to Beijing. And when they were attacked, the bureaucrats feared losing power to explorers. They convinced the new emperor to abandon exploration, cut off incentives and resources for exploration, grounded ships, destroyed evidence, destroyed maps, sealed the ports, and the effects of that are visible to this day. Ironically, until this happened, China had a highly eclectic policy. They were very open to the world. The imperial school taught over 20 languages. Zheng He himself was a Muslim eunuch, and his pilots were Arabs and Tamil navigators. Again, what if? Now contrast that experience with that of Christopher Columbus, another innovator with an idea. Christopher Columbus was Genoese. Is from Italy, what's now Italy. But Christopher Columbus did not explore under the Genoese flag. And that was because he had pitched his idea to the Genoese and they said no. So he pitched it to the Venetians, he pitched it to the French, he pitched it to the Portuguese, who were very far ahead on this. He pitched it to practically every European power. Christopher Columbus had the door shut on his face 9 times. It was on his 10th attempt that Queen Isabella and the Spanish court, after having said no once before, supported his venture. Christopher Columbus, unlike Cheng He, had the luxury of having the door slammed in his face 9 times. At that time, the Spanish also offered Christopher Columbus some very strong incentives. So here are some of the incentives. He would get the rank of nobility right away. Upon success, rank of admiral, so success-based incentives. Viceroy and governor, all titles to be hereditary. And the best bit, a commission of 10% of the proceeds from all commerce in the new lands. Needless to say, they reneged on the deal and put him in jail, but that's a different story. Christopher Columbus was also a risk-taker. Biographers of Columbus point out only a fool with a new theory would sail off into an ocean without a very specific idea of where he was going. The Norse, for instance, who had been to the Americas before, always had a specific idea. Now, I wanted to start with this historical context because the story of Cheng He relative to Christopher Columbus has parallels and implications and lessons for each of us as we think about innovation, and each of us as companies that try to build a culture of innovation. In fact, as we have looked at companies that have sustained an outcome, a series of outcomes around innovation, positive innovation, over time, the one line that describes it is actually the first line from Leo Tolstoy, the Anna Karenina classic book. The first line from Leo Tolstoy's classic Anna Karenina is, "Happy families are all alike. Every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way." In fact, what we find in our research is exactly the same thing. Innovative firms are all alike. Every laggard is a laggard in its own way. Innovative firms seem to share a set of traits that seem common, no matter where they're located, no matter which industry they're in, which geography they're in, how large they are, more generally speaking, they seem to share a few traits. They share a set of mindsets, attitudes, and a set of practices. In your, at your chairs, seats, is a little handout. If you don't have one, there will be some in the neighborhood. And in there is a version of the survey instrument that we used in some of our earlier work, a short version of our survey instrument that describes some of this. Let me just note a few aspects to this. One has to do with the extent to which companies focus on the future. Now, this seems like a really simple thing. It turns out, as we'll see later, to be a relatively rare thing. The extent to which senior managers within companies focus on the future relative to the present or the past. The second has to do with the extent to which businesses are willing to destroy the investments they themselves have built, a willingness to cannibalize. A third is the extent to which they tolerate calculated risks. These are in the mindsets. Now, there are also certain practices that seem to be shared across all of these innovative companies. They promote champions of innovations, individuals like Christopher Columbus, like Cheng He. They offer incentives. And here's the thing about the incentives. They were asymmetric in nature. How? The rewards to success are substantially higher than punishment for failure. So it's not that failure is never punished, but you know as an innovator that if you succeed, the rewards will be much higher than the punishment for failure. And finally, they operated as internal markets. There was competition and there was autonomy and decentralization within these companies. Rather than get into this in detail, let me just note one thing. First of all, to say congratulations to each of you. What you have, the very fact that you are here today implies something about your own thinking, your own mindset, and what it might imply for a culture of innovation in your own companies. Because these six factors we just talked about, mindsets and practices, by far the strongest predictor of innovation was the first one. The extent to which senior managers focus on the future relative to the past or the present. Now, you might think, if you're a senior manager, one of your main jobs is to focus on the future, create a vision for the future, among other things. Any guesses as to what percentage of senior managers' time in large corporations is spent on future-oriented activities, especially the medium to long-term future, relative to the past or the present? What percentage of the typical senior manager's time is spent on the future relative to the past or present? So my colleagues have followed CEOs around, as well as senior managers, and actually have calculated this number. What do you think is the number? Any guesses? 10%? 10%? 5? 4? You must work in relatively, you're probably a self-selected group. In large corporations, it seems scarily low. These are the individuals who everybody else in the organization expects will create a vision of the future, will help the organization maneuver through the future. The good news is already you've met your weekly, certainly weekly, the what-if questions all day today. So let me pose that question. What if every company in this room had a culture of innovation? If every company in this room, represented by the individuals in this room, had a culture of innovation, on that audit, on that document that I gave to you, in those set of practices, attitudes and practices, you would fare relatively high on the questions I asked you there. Can I ask that you take about 5 minutes to fill out this first page in that one pager, the handout that's in there. If you don't have one, just ask, and the individual, our folks there will get you one. This way here. Once you've had a chance to complete the first page, could you turn to the person next to you and compare, assuming they've filled it out, compare what you said and what might be different. You can ignore the second page for now. And by the way, across in our first study on this topic, across 17 countries and 773 companies, the averages were roughly around 4. So, 5 minutes just to have a brief discussion with the person next to you, and then we'll take some feedback, insights, discussion before going in further. Okay, in 2 minutes, I'll ask for your debrief on what you took away. Sort of one insight you want to share. Okay, hold that thought. We'll come back to that. Yeah. 2 minutes. Okay, I know this was somewhat rushed and you're talking to strangers, but that was part of the idea here. Debrief, the gentleman here had an insight, please. There'll be a mic coming to you.
I think younger companies are more prone to adopt innovative culture than companies which have been in the business for long, and especially if they've been successful.
Okay, so age of the company matters. So what would you say is young? At what point is there a tipping point?
I think after 10 years, if you've survived the first 10 years, the curve is drastically reducing.
Really? So after 10 years, it's bad news, potentially, is what you're saying. How many in our group here work for companies older than 10 years? Okay, well, geez, I hate to break it to you. Apparently, things will not look good. On the other hand, there are exceptions. There are lots of them. And there are lessons to be learned from those exceptions. And there is value to comparing yourself relative to those exceptions. Yeah, good point, yes. Other insights? Yes. Mike here, please.
Hi, my name is Ahmad Badr. I work for a company that's actually 150 years old. And it's called Cargill. In that sense, we're talking a lot about creating an innovation culture in our company or sustaining it. The two questions that you have in the survey, the first two questions are actually what struck me most. When you put challenging performance targets for the next year and the next year and the next year, and sometimes you're not meeting them, that creates a very short-term focus, even at the very top of the house.
Absolutely.
And the second question is also the customers. We talk about being partners of choice to our customers, which is great, and we strive to serve their needs and their future needs. but I don't think we necessarily pay high enough attention to future customers.
Yeah.
What does the future customer look like? What are their needs? Yeah. And how we can anticipate that.
Absolutely.
So those are two observations.
And it's an excellent point, Ahmed. So do you know roughly what the sales levels of Cargill might have been last year, roughly? Just is it revenues, yes.
$130 billion.
Yeah, you know your numbers quite well. So $130 billion. What do you think is a reasonable growth target for the next year?
So that's revenues. We measure ourselves on earnings.
Okay.
We achieved, I think, a $1.7 billion in earnings.
Billion.
Thereabouts. We target actually to be in the 2.7 or thereabouts. So that's...
But in the next
70%,
year?
70%, yeah.
In the next year, you want to double your...
Less than double, but yeah, that's the target.
Okay, so...
Because our target for this year was not met, so...
Okay. So if you want to double earnings, or close to double earnings, and now you're encouraging innovation to do so, and you want to double earnings in the next year, what kind of innovation is likely to come out as successful to create an impact on a company that large? Odds are, it is something that already exists. It may well involve buying an innovation from somewhere else. Does that really create a culture of innovation? That's a question to ask. Imagine there are entrepreneurs, perhaps outsiders, perhaps just people with the Christopher Columbuses or the Cheng He's of Cargill. They have ideas. They'll probably take 5 years, 10 years. But if the pressure is on doubling or whatever the number is, then imagine the impact that'll have. Don't come to me if I'm top manager. Don't come to me unless your idea is worth at least in the hundreds of millions, rather than now or in the next year. Don't come to me with future-oriented. This is one of the challenges. You're absolutely right. Yeah. Other insights? Yes, please.
My name is David Mata. I'm at LBS. 25 years of experience in the Middle East and Saudi Arabia in particular. We scored between 4 and 5, and probably 1 is 7. And my observation is that the internal cultural environment of the company is related to the macro environment of where you're working with. This, like, I've seen that most of my other companies or colleagues that are working at other companies are more or less the same.
Yeah.
It's not like a culture of innovation.
Yeah.
And it seems that innovation goes in clusters more than, or it's a general mood of being innovative, you know, in some cultures. This is one. The second thing is that if you score low on the first question, most probably you'll be scoring low on all the 12, basically. So it boils down to mindset, you know, whether really you are... you know, you want to, maybe sometimes depending upon the nature of the business, we're in the retail automotive, so there's not too much innovation in the cars, we're not the ones that manufactured them, but probably process innovation or improvement, you know, constant improvement.
Yeah.
So these are the thoughts, you know.
Absolutely. You know, the evolutionary biologist Stephen Jay Gould had a wonderful line about how evolution happens. He says, you know, evolution, the story of evolution is one of long periods of boredom punctuated by a few moments of sheer terror. So you're right. Certain industries, perhaps in certain geographies, may be going through long periods of boredom. But it's very, that implies that there are opportunities to create creative destruction, shall we say, right? Where there are those moments. And in fact, some might argue those moments are happening more and more frequently because of the ideas that are moving around back and forth throughout the world. So that may well imply opportunity for innovation if that is the kind of industry you're in. And then people tend to catch up, which is a theme we'll discuss in a few minutes. Yes, thank you. Other inputs, yes. I would love to get some input from our backbenchers back there. Yes, in a sec. Yes.
I would say that ownership has a big impact here because if we're talking about large public companies, for example, then to sustain a culture of innovation is very difficult. And of course, the prime examples are the large pharma companies and the difficulties they're having with their pipelines of drugs. I chair a private equity fund, and I find that we can score pretty highly here by the nature of that particular business model. We happen to be focused on one particular sector. I would say also probably private companies. One can also therefore see that they could probably have a much greater focus on innovation simply by nature of the ownership of businesses.
It's a profoundly important point you raise. In fact, there's been some research on the impact of governance, specifically on family-run businesses, relative to founder-led businesses, relative to private equity-owned businesses and dispersed shareholders. So think of those four categories of businesses, yeah? One is family-owned. The second is private equity-owned, dispersed shareholder, and there was a third one, founder-led. Which of these do you think have, on average, the best, which are the best run companies in these classes of companies? Any guesses? Family? In fact, family-owned and founder-led companies, on average, tend to be among the worst run. Now, what you're alluding to is that there are some families that are visionary and do not fight with themselves, some families where you have individuals who are doing the right thing or somehow have managed to create a culture. Very often it is, you know, what am I going to do? It's time for my inheritance, or it's time for my retirement. Or founder-led, you know, back when I was a young man, we used to do things that way. Don't tell me about this digital or, you know, emerging markets or whatever else stuff. That is often the flip side of that. So while governance can matter, the point overall about geography as well as governance is that in each of these cases, there are exceptions. There are more lessons to be learned from those exceptions in either direction than by looking at the averages within those clusters. That's point one. Point two is that the exceptions across geographies, whether in the Middle East or in Silicon Valley or among family businesses relative to dispersed shareholder businesses, the exceptions that have a culture of innovation tend to look towards each other. Not to other family businesses, not to other Middle Eastern companies. They tend to look to each other. So you could be an Indian company, you would see as your peer Silicon Valley companies. You could be a family-run company, you see as your peer others, at least in the dimension of building a culture of innovation. That's both the risk as well as the opportunity. Thank you for that. There were some folks back there. Yes.
Hello, sir. I'm Vishnu, MBA 2017, and head of products at Wonga Group. One of the observations that I've had, especially at Wonga, is the impact of regulation and its impact on innovation at the firm. That's number one. And number two is when we innovated initially, it was probably because we were a bunch of outsiders without prior financial services experience. But we've changed in the sense that our leadership now is more seasoned with previous financial services background. And that coupled with compliance and regulatory requirements has meant that we had to slow down ourselves, get things correct, and then innovate. So it's this atmosphere of change and how that impacts innovation.
Yeah. That's a very good point. First of all, congratulations. 2017, you haven't yet joined and you're already affiliated. I love it. Congratulations on LBS. And your point about change and regulation is a very good one. Now, on the point about regulation, very often this means you take the eyes off of the customer and trends in the marketplace and you focus on the crises that exist right now, or what today's regulators may say about you, and that certainly has an impact, absolutely. We'll take one last question and then, yes. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Barty. I'm also a 2017 LBS admit. Before now, I've been working for an enormously innovative organization in frontier markets, mostly in Africa, mostly in healthcare and pharmaceuticals. And what I found over 4 years working with them was that this very, very strong culture of innovation, when we were very small, led to all sorts of new divisions and groups and very exciting projects coming up within the organization that in turn led to very dramatic growth of the organization that we hadn't necessarily predicted. And with time, that growth was not sustainable. Management consolidated very, very strongly and chopped off a lot of those new exciting divisions. Yeah. And this caused very significant rifts within the organization as a whole. And I'd say as many problems as it had initially solved. So my question for you is then, you know, how can success in innovation really be defined? And at what point does the risk of success become something that you have to consider as well?
Yeah. And some call it the Icarus paradox, after the creature from Greek mythology whose own success led to his downfall. You know, he flew so high, he fell to the sea. And that is a danger in many, many fast-growing companies in particular. And what it illustrates is the essential dilemma and essential contradiction in innovation. The challenge of innovation the art of innovation is the art of managing contradictions. On the one hand, you have to think about the future. On the other hand, you have to deal with the present here and now. On the one hand, you have to create chaos within the company. On the other hand, you have to have systems and processes. On the one hand, you have to compete actively with some companies. On the other hand, you have to collaborate with the very same companies. So this is the dilemma. And the next set of materials I have on that second page is about helping each of us think through that dilemma. And that's what makes, actually, there are no sort of very easy answers. It's about constantly questioning where we stand and what the right way to make that balance at this moment in time might be. The wonderful line from Andy Grove, the Intel CEO's book, former Intel CEO's book, is, "Only the paranoid survive." And the successful companies that are continuously innovative tend to have that sense of paranoia about, are we doing the right thing right now? And they tend to be quite worried about themselves. So let me summarize and end by noting a few things. What we've talked about so far is taking a somewhat fuzzy concept of that's ethereal, it's hard to pin down, of culture, and making it something specific. Looking at the exceptions, which many of you pointed out, that exist, and learning from them to make it more common within our geographies, within our industries, to share a culture of innovation. I want to end by pointing out that actually some of the most effective cultures of innovation exist in some of the scariest enterprises, shall we say, in the world. And they learn from each other too. Terrorists learn from each other. And those six dimensions of mindsets and practices we've been talking about, some of them share the exact same thing. A colleague of mine, Jamie Pennebaker at the University of Texas, has examined the speeches of terrorists, Osama bin Laden versus Ayman al-Zawahiri, for instance. Turned out, the surprising thing from these analyses of language is that Osama bin Laden turns out to be, in his speeches, part of the effectiveness in is his vision for the future. They do it, but the good news is many of us are doing it too. Many of us are learning from the likes of Apple, where Steve Jobs pointed out right now is one of those moments when we are influencing the future. We have power over our future. You know, let me end with a note And this is a frequent setup that Steve Jobs used to use, one more thing. You've seen this. This is also something that his successor has used, you know, in part sort of taking forward the culture of innovation that Apple brought in. I know Pascal Cagnies will be joining us. He used to be one of the leaders in Apple and pointing out the culture of innovation that exists within Apple. But we also see individuals like these. This gentleman, anyone recognize him? Well, maybe this. His name is Lei Jun. He's the founder of a company called Xiaomi. Xiaomi is, at this point, the most highly valued startup in the world, shall we say. They recently raised $1.1 billion from venture capitalists, and their current valuation is $45 billion. Now, their founder makes few qualms about learning from Apple. But at the same time, if you follow what they're doing remarkably innovative things. A culture is being built, partly, by the way, by bringing in the likes of Hugo Barra, who used to run the mobiles operation for Google, now works for Xiaomi. So bringing in learning from others, bringing in others from other cultures. And having started as an imitator, Xiaomi last year was ranked by Fast Company magazine as one of the world's 50 most innovative companies. So let me end with one more thing. You know, when the independence struggle in India was going badly, and it seemed like change would never happen, many went to Gandhi, people went to Gandhi and said, you know, I'm powerless against these forces. I'm so tiny against these huge forces. What can I do? And Gandhi's message was, be the change you want to see in the world. And so let me end by, what if we could be the change we want to see in the world? Thank you very much.